We're going to shift gears a little bit, talk about another aspect of leadership that we will all encounter, again, regardless of whether we have a position or a title. We will all encounter situations where we have to help people stay motivated. And I will tell you, as a leadership professor and a consultant, I probably get asked to speak more on how to keep people engaged, really, than on any other topic. Maybe with the exception of conflict management, we always tend to get into fights and arguments as well. But keeping people engaged seems like a giant mystery for most of us. And if you're anything like me, when I was an active member, I had no idea how to do any of this. So my hope is I can give you some insights, a couple things to think about, and again, stuff that you can take back to your chapters right away and start putting into practice. So with that in mind, let's kind of jump into some things. And I probably should start by asking just a very simple question. When you think about people, the folks that are in our chapters, in our bands, in any other team or organization that we might be in, or think about ourselves a bit more specifically, why do folks join groups? What do you think? Why did you join KKSI? Why did you join the band? Why do folks join organizations like this?
It's either like something they're interested in, they don't hire people who are also interested in that, places like you.
Okay, so they're folks are interested in something. What else?
They'd like to be a part of something that's bigger than themselves.
Okay, I'd like to be part of something, belong to something bigger than them.
It makes them feel welcome.
Feel welcome. What else?
Along with familiar faces that you can get started.
Faces are nice, friends, you know, groups tend to shrink things, especially campuses, especially larger campuses. Shrinking that down is always helpful.
It helps create like a sense of personal identity.
Absolutely, helps with identity.
Help people grow.
Helps folks grow. Give me one more.
Maybe to try something new.
Try something new. Absolutely, and again, great list. I just threw a couple of things on here, but you all have touched on this. Fundamentally, people join organizations for a sense of belonging. That is just a fundamental piece of human nature, and if any of you have taken just some basic psychology classes, you'll know that a sense of belonging is something that motivates people very tremendously at times. Another reason, though, is that some people want a sense of purpose, and again, we sort of mentioned this, maybe something a little bit bigger than ourselves, but we join groups that kind of give us a sense of direction that we may not otherwise have on our own. We also join stuff that sort of have principles or values that we hold dear. Maybe a mission that we think is important. Maybe that's something that kind of got us into KKSI in the first place, a mission to support the band, and that was a shared set of beliefs and goals that we all had. If you think about this, once you join a group, what happens next? And again, whether it's you, with any group that you belong to, or just people generally speaking, once you say, yes, I'll do something, or I'll join this, what next? What's the next step? What happens? What do you think?
You get to know and meet with the people who are also in the group.
Okay, you can talk to some other folks. What else?
You have access to, you know, resources or people, experiences that you didn't have before.
Okay, hopefully you have access to stuff that you wouldn't have had otherwise. What else?
You start looking for ways to get more involved.
Okay, maybe you become more involved.
You kind of begin to gain a new perspective of people. It's sort of like, it feels kind of, I would say, form judgments, but just sort of, you get to know people on a different level and see where you, like, you know, fit in best.
Sure, you get some additional perspective, sometimes some biases, but that's all right. We get additional experiences that we wouldn't have had otherwise. I think that's great. We're also missing some basic things. So a lot of what we answered were things that are more in the ideal. Well, let's face it, we have some folks that join just because they want to put something on a resume. That's it. And so all this other stuff about learning and growing and gaining new experiences and meeting new people and all that, that's fantastic. But we know that doesn't apply to everyone. That we have folks that literally just do this for the line on the resume. That's it. Now, outside of those, our hope is that people will join and then start participating in some way, shape, or form with that organization. But we know that's not always the case. So ideally, we move people from that, just put it on a resume, into some kind of participation. But maybe that's something that we have to get involved in, because sometimes this just doesn't happen naturally. And then among the people who participate, we also get a subset that at some point lead, either in a formal capacity with a position or a title, or in an informal capacity without that position. But recognize, again, these are additional steps that not everyone takes. Everybody gets to list the organization on the resume. Not everybody participates, and not everybody leads. So when you think about these latter two categories, that's where we need to focus our attention. How do we move people from just listing, say, Kappa Psi on the resume into some sort of meaningful participation, maybe even some aspect of leadership, and sustain that for the long term? But to do this, in order for anybody to move beyond that first category, there is one fundamental thing that's required. And what do you think it is?
Passion.
Passion? Possibly. That helps. Maybe not necessarily be a requirement, though. What else?
Drive.
Drive? Possibly. I might throw that in the same camp with passion.
Support.
Support. Helpful, but also not necessary. What do you think? Effort, again, possibly, but not necessary. I know folks that get thrown into positions with absolutely no effort, just nobody else signed up.
You need to have the right attitude.
That would be nice. Again, not necessary though. We've encountered situations where people have the wrong attitude and they're still doing stuff. So think about it, a little bit more basic than where our minds kind of, where our minds are centered right now.
You have to want to do it.
Again, not necessary. Ideally, yes. But I know a bunch of people that get dragged kicking and screaming into either participatory roles or leadership roles. And that's the last thing they want to do. So give me one more.
Respect.
Well, again, that would be nice, but it's not necessary. I know a bunch of people, this is going to sound bad. I work with a bunch of people who are in formal leadership positions above me, supervisory roles above me, and I do not respect them at all, because they haven't done anything to earn it. But I will tell you, at a very basic level, in order to move yourself from the list on a resume into either participate or leadership, here's what you need. Time. That's it. In order to move yourself from just being a name on a roll into something more substantive, more meaningful, it requires time. Your time. If you are going to be more than just a name on a list, you have to devote time. If you're going to show up and do a service project, guess what? It takes time. If you're going to lead, guess what? It takes time. So that's fundamentally what we're dealing with. Time. And if you think about time. Because unlike anything, you know, whether you're measuring time in seconds, whether you're measuring it in terms of minutes, hours, days of the week, whatever, time is something that we have in equal amounts. It is the only commodity that every person has in equal amounts. Not like money, because that varies across people. Not like attractiveness, intelligence, or talent. All of those things are variable. The only thing that is constant is time. And for every one of us, we have 24 hours in a day. That's it. I don't get more time because I'm older. You don't get more time because you're in school. We all have 24 hours. And so you think about your day. spend that time. Well, again, for all of us, we can break up the day into two major categories. What we have to do and what we want to do. That's it. And think about it. There's stuff that we have to do. We have to sleep. We have to eat. If we don't do either of those things, we die. That would be bad. Right? We have to go to class. We may not want to, but we have to go to class. We have to go to work. If we don't, we get fired. There's a lot of things that we have to do. And that makes up the vast bulk of our day. The stuff that we have to do. The remaining part. It's all based on what we want to do. And that's where Kappa Kappa Psi fits in. That's where any of these organizations that we might join and want to participate in and get new experiences and directions, this all fits in here. And guess what? There's a ton of other crap that fits into that same space. There's a lot of stuff clamoring for our time. And we have to figure out how to allocate it. And the average person is going through the exact same thing. So when we talk about motivating people, this is fundamentally what we have to wrap our minds around. How do we get people to devote that small fraction of their day, that what they want to do, towards something that we would like participating in the chapter? That's fundamentally what we have to figure out. And so you think about it. How do people basically allocate their time in that small portion? That what I want to do segment of that day. Well, again, there are two very basic motivations. First, it's just all spur-of-the-moment stuff. And we know, no matter what we plan, if a buddy calls up and says, hey, why don't we go see the latest cool film? Chances are, any plans we have get thrown out the window because, God, that just sounds a whole lot more attractive than cramming for my test tomorrow. It just happens. And again, that never goes away even when you get older. I still get lured away by spur-of-the-moment stuff because that's fun, right? The planned stuff really kind of sucks. And so spur-of-the-moment things are very, very powerful motivators. But the other thing, the opposite, is what we plan. And when we start planning how to use that small piece of our day for what we want to do, we tend to allocate time based on priorities. And so as we're trying to be more effective leaders, again, this is what we need to think about. What would make or motivate a person to place a higher priority on spending their limited time with your group, with your chapter, than doing something else? And that's what we need to start thinking about. So how do we prioritize? What do you think? Well, how do people make priorities?
You have to sacrifice and see what's more beneficial to you in a positive way.
Okay, so sometimes we prioritize just based on selfish stuff. What are we going to get the most benefit out of? What else?
Sometimes it just comes down to like a deadline. So, you know, when signs are coming up on Friday, it's going to get done before the sign is coming up on Sunday.
Okay, so deadlines are great motivators. What else do we use to prioritize time?
Sometimes like the pressure from other people and from others that are saying, okay, you have to do this rather than something else that nobody's really telling you you have to do, and you're obviously doing the thing that'll please the other people that are bringing up to you.
Okay, so peer pressure, good thing.
I was gonna almost to kind of blow off that, not only like in a pressure sense, but like finding like time where people want to meet and do things together, like if you have a group, like maybe not in a pressure sense, but like putting it in a time where it's convenient for everyone.
Okay, so maybe you can only get together collectively at a certain time. What else? What else helps us or makes us prioritize?
I feel like the amount of emphasis that you put on a task, like how big it is, how important it is, maybe like it's homework, you know. Maybe this is worth 100 points, and so I need to spend more time on it than this like 20 or 50 point assignment.
Sure, so the importance of the task. Mm-hmm. And well, give me one more.
Responsibility to others. So if I don't do this thing, I'm going to let 30 people down, so I've got to do that first.
Absolutely. So again, great list. You guys are doing fantastic. So I just put a couple things up on here, but our list I think is obviously much better. So one of the things that we use to help prioritize, and we mentioned this, some kind of accomplishment or a sense of fulfillment that we might get by allocating our time towards that group. That will help us prioritize things. It's somewhat of a selfish thing, but it's selfish in a very good way. We prioritize based on things that we feel we get a personal benefit out of. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's just basic human nature. We also tend to prioritize groups that have a clear direction or are moving in sort of with a clear sense of purpose, as opposed to groups that are just kind of meandering around, maybe kind of walking around in circles with no real sense of goal or vision or direction. We tend to like groups that can kind of chart a path for us, and we tend to allocate more time towards those groups. Another reason we prioritize, and we've said this as well, if we have personal responsibility. Now, if we have to do something for that group, because we'll let a bunch of people down if we don't otherwise, then we'll tend to prioritize and spend some time with that group. And therein lies our dilemma. So as leaders, again, regardless of whether we have a position or a title, as leaders, our dilemma or our problem, the thing we have to focus on, is providing that clear meaning and purpose for every member of our team. Because that's what they're going to need in order to prioritize our group over something else. If we don't, then our team starts dropping in that list of priorities. So you think about this. Say we have a chapter of 20 or 25 people. That's 20 or 25 lives that we have to try and figure out, will our chapter give them some sense of purpose, meaning, fulfillment, so that they will prioritize what we do over something else? And that's not an easy thing. That's like a really hard thing, and it's so hard that corporations literally spend hundreds of thousands of dollars, in some case even millions of dollars, to hire people who do nothing other than try and figure out this question, so that their members remain motivated, remain engaged. Because if they're not, then they just phone it in, and that team starts to stagnate. And maybe you've seen a situation in your chapter where folks start phoning it in, they only start doing the bare minimum, they never show up to do service, or whatever the chapter is trying to do, and things start to stagnate. But that means it's on us, it's on our shoulders to try and figure out how to provide that direction, that sense of purpose, that meaning, so that people will place our team higher on that list of priorities. So let me give you some things to think about that we can then apply to try and figure out this dilemma. So, good place to begin. In terms of keeping people engaged, I want you to think fundamentally just two things. Again, I told you, I like to keep things kind of simple. So we're just going to talk about two things. One of which is a term called motivating the middle. And it's based on a book that was written by someone else. We'll go into detail a little bit more in just a few minutes. But it's focusing on the right group of people within our chapter, and trying to motivate them to place a higher priority on what we do. Second thing, maybe we have to restructure our meetings. Because maybe our meetings are aligned in such a way that it's sending the exact wrong signal out to our members. And that signal is, hey, every time we get together, we're not doing anything important, which means, hey, I'm gonna be more likely to blow it off. Because if I'm not getting any sense of purpose or direction out of a meeting, why would I allocate my limited time to sit in a room and just stare at each other for an hour, or beat a dead horse for an hour, or whatever we do in chapter meetings that maybe frustrate some folks. So we're going to focus on those two things, motivating the middle, choosing the right types of people to kind of focus our attention on, and maybe change up how we run our typical meetings. Okay? So let's take this first one. Excuse me. Screaming out BAM kind of gave me a little stretch. So motivating the middle. I told you this was by a book written by a guy named T.J. Sullivan. And T.J. Sullivan, I don't know if you've heard of the organization Campus Speak. They've got a bunch of leadership speakers that go to university and college campuses all over. T.J. Sullivan founded this group. And he wrote this book, Motivating the Middle. And if you have a chance to read it, I would highly recommend it. It's only about 80 pages long. So it's a quick and easy read. But it's really insightful about organizations generally, fraternities, sororities more specifically, and the challenges they have in terms of motivating folks. And for TJ, he looks at any organization and basically breaks out its members into three different groups that he just labels in various obvious terms: the top group, the middle group, the bottom group. That's it. And he talks about the characteristics of each of those levels. And generally speaking, every group has all three. Your top group is maybe about 10 or 15% of the membership. The bottom group is also about 10 or 15% of the membership. And the remaining middle is 70 to 80%. So that middle group is the core of any team, any organization, any chapter. And then Sullivan goes through each of those groups. So let me just kind of summarize quickly what he says about each one. And for that bottom group, these are the problem children that we tend to deal with all the time and frustrate the crap out of us. These are folks that are least likely to sacrifice their time for the rest of the team. They're the ones that we constantly have disciplinary issues about. They behave badly at all of the events that we have, any of the obligations we ask them to do, like, I don't know, paying dues, they avoid. So these tend to be folks that move in and out of, say, inactive status for us. Any other commitments we ask them to make, they tend to skimp out on those. When they come and show up to things, they essentially just criticize. And they criticize in a very loud, public, visible kind of manner. And so they truly cause a tremendous amount of problems for the organization. You take the opposite, the top group, again, 10 to 15% of any team. These are the folks that are going to spend the vast majority of that want-to-do piece of the pie working for the chapter. These are the ones that sort of live, breathe, eat, and sleep Kappa Kappa Psi, or whatever team we might be in. And what's kind of interesting about this group is they have a real hard time understanding why everybody else isn't like them. And it's through no fault of their own, and I don't mean this in a critical kind of way, it's just a general observation. They spend so much of their time working for that chapter that they don't understand why everybody else doesn't spend every waking minute doing exactly what they do. They just fundamentally can't wrap their mind around it. Which means for that bottom group that is least likely to spend their time, the top group fixates on them constantly. Because that is just a thorn in their side. And it just frustrates them to hell. They literally cannot stop talking about that bottom group. And if they carry on like this for too long, there is a distinct possibility that at some point in time, they will burn out. They will get so frustrated because everybody else isn't allocating all of their extra time towards the fraternity that they just burn out. They get so frustrated, they shut down. So we've got the bottom group that doesn't do much of anything, the top group that can't do anything else, and then everybody else falls in the middle. And this is where Sullivan says we need to focus most of our efforts, because this middle group is what will make or break any team, any organization, any chapter. This middle group cares about what we do. There's no question about that. They joined our chapter because of those basic principles, values, all the stuff that we talked about earlier. They joined, they care, they want to see the team, the chapter, be successful. And they've got a really good attitude about what we're doing. And when asked, they're happy to contribute. But this group isn't their highest priority. And that's okay. They don't live, breathe, eat, and sleep, Kappa Kappa Psi. There are other things that have just as high, if not higher, priorities than our chapter. And that's okay. What's funny is that they get really frustrated when we start talking about why people don't spend more of their limited time working for the chapter. They're the ones that get more frustrated when the drama erupts between the top group and the bottom group than anybody else, because they view that drama as a waste of their time. Time that they could allocate towards something else. And when it comes to their participation, they've got some great ideas, but rarely will they just offer those things up proactively, let alone volunteer themselves to take on a leadership role or run point on a particular project, because they don't want to risk stepping on the toes of the people in the top group. So they're there, they want to be used, they care about the success of the organization, but they're not going to volunteer themselves because they don't want to step on somebody else's toes, and there are other groups that are also clamoring for their time. So there's our three groups: the bottom, the middle, the top. So how can we build off of this? What sort of insights can we use based on Sullivan's analysis? Well, one of the things that he says, if you want to motivate this middle group, which is anywhere from 70 to 80% of your chapter, the vast majority of your members fall into this category. If you want to motivate them to stay engaged with what the chapter is doing, fundamentally, you've got to quit focusing on the bottom. And I don't know about you, I don't know if your chapter meetings spend a decent amount of time talking about disciplinary issues. When I was active, my chapter seemed to fix on that a lot. Whether it was placing some people formally on probation or suspension, or for lack of a better term, pardon my language, just bitching about the fact that people didn't come and show up for a particular project. We spent an inordinate amount of time complaining about how people didn't participate. And Sullivan says, you just gotta stop. Just gotta stop complaining about that. Set some very basic, minimal standards. And if people make it, great. Let them participate when they want. But if they can't make the basic minimum requirements, then cut them loose. Don't make excuses for them. Don't stand up trying to defend them. Just say, look, you're either going to meet us at this level or not. And if you meet us at this level, we're happy to have you come along. But if you can't meet us here, then it's best that we both part ways. You just set those standards and quit wasting time talking about why people do or do not participate. So there's one thing, bless you, one thing to think about. But another thing, and more pointedly towards that group in the middle, that's the folks that we focus on. And so if you think about this, If people are going to allocate their time based on priorities, based on a sense of direction, based on a sense of mission, then we need to make sure that we have communicated a clear sense of direction of where we want to go as a chapter. And we need to talk about that all the time to keep people connected into that larger mission or purpose or set of goals. We can't just say at the first meeting, this is what we're going to do over the year, and never talk about it again, because people will tend to forget. We have to constantly reinforce, we're doing this because it's helping us get here. That will help this middle group stay engaged. Another thing is we have to reach out to them and ask them to lead on particular things. Remember, they've got great ideas and they want to contribute, but they won't do it proactively out of fear of stepping on the toes of folks in the top group. So we got to reach out to them and say, hey, can you help with this? And chances are, when we ask, they will say yes, and they'll be really happy that they got asked. Because they want to contribute, just maybe not 24/7, but maybe just on a little piece of the puzzle. And if we ask them, they'll be very gracious that we ask for their help. Another thing Sullivan says that we have to do is publicly recognize when they contribute. Because I don't know about you, again, this is one thing that I saw when I was active, and when I work with active chapters still around the country, I see this all the time. We don't recognize people for the good things they do. We bitch and moan when somebody does something wrong, and we complain, and we point fingers, and we place blame, and all that stuff. We don't reward people for doing something right. And if we have a group that's 80% of our chapter that is trying to figure out, should I spend more time with this or not? If we're not thanking people for the contributions they make, then they're not going to feel wanted. And guess where they're going to allocate their time? Someplace else. So we ask them to lead on specific things and then recognize when they've contributed in order to give them that sense of personal benefit. And that brings us kind of to our next point. And this is now separate from what Sullivan wrote. But you think about meetings and the opportunities that we have when we get together. I'm curious, for your own specific chapters, why do you meet? Yeah.
A lot of it is to update the regular brothers of the chapter, what members of exec, we're like any work that's been done by other brothers that might not be common knowledge.
Okay, so we give out a bunch of information. All right, why else do we meet?
Pass money to the funded project.
All right, we need money. Why else?
Collaborate on opportunities to service the bands, like say, we need this person to do this, we need this person to do this, there's a sign up sheet that goes around.
Okay, so we brainstorm, we plan. Okay, why else?
Ask board members for suggestions for if the committee was working on something and they got stuff, then go to the rest of them.
Okay, so we get ideas from more people?
If the chapter is starting to take on a really big project, just to talk to the rest of the brotherhood about it and get their take on it.
Okay, when we're taking on something big, then we need to get input from more people. What else?
Sometimes we like to have, occasionally during chapter, we'll have, times for introspection, remind us why we joined the Brotherhood and kind of reevaluate what Brotherhood means and our fraternity values are.
Cool. So we kind of reconnect to those basic purposes, that mission. Awesome. Give me one more.
Planning or executing social or Brotherhood activities.
Okay, maybe we try and do some fun stuff too, right? Okay. I think those are all great. So I just threw a couple of these out. Most of our meeting is spent sharing information. That's it. That's the vast majority. In any meeting for any organization, this is easily somewhere between 60 and 80% of the time that we have in that meeting. It's just all about providing information. Occasionally, and we said it, we'll use our opportunity collectively to solve some problems. Stuff that we couldn't do individually or in committees or whatever, we use this opportunity to solve some of those problems. How many of us spend that time recognizing contributions from individuals? Some, not a whole lot. Right? And again, if your chapter doesn't do this, don't feel bad. The average chapter doesn't. They just don't. Give me a second. We'll get right back. Connecting into that larger purpose, that mission. Again, a lot of groups don't do this. I'm part of several organizations that do not do this, like ever. And so it's really hard then if we're supposed to make that connection for people in the middle and we don't spend time to make that connection. Guess what? People don't allocate their time towards that organization. And so you think about our chapter meetings. And I'm curious. Do your meetings sort of look like that? Roughly?
Yeah.
Right? Maybe a little exceptions here and there, but generally speaking, we have a bunch of reports. Old business, new business. Right? And again, most, I'd say 95% of the organizations I'm a part of, that is the general structure that we follow. Those first two, all we do is convey information. That's it. The second two is sort of a combination of conveying information and then maybe solving some problems or getting input on stuff that we need. Just think about this. You know, that particular structure. Exciting or boring?
Boring.
Boring. Like pretty much hands down. Boring. Think about it. If we're trying to keep people motivated and engaged to show up and allocate their time, and then we bore the crap out of them at the times that we get together, how likely are they to allocate time in the future? It starts to drop a little bit, doesn't it? So you think about this. That the perception of that meeting is really what we're kind of talking about. Do folks think those meetings are interesting? Do they think they're useful, helpful? Or are they just bored to death, maybe frustrated, because all we do is sort of argue, complain, whatever, focus on the bottom group, whatever that is. If the answer is not that our meetings are interesting, useful, beneficial, then perhaps we need to change what we do. If the answer for our average person is our meetings are boring and unproductive, then perhaps we need to change up what we do. So let me give you a couple of things to think about. Fundamentally, ask yourself the question, what's the key takeaway you want from any meeting you have with your group? A lot of us, when we start planning meetings, we don't think about that part. We just say, oh, you know, we have to meet every Sunday or every Tuesday night or whatever day of the week our typical chapter meeting is. We just have to meet then because that's what we have to do. And we don't give any sense or any thought to what we want our members to take away from that gathering. And if we don't have a takeaway for our chapter, then guess what? It's going to be real hard for them to start thinking, why should I allocate my time to go here? If there's nothing identifiable that I take away from that meeting, why go when I can spend my time on something else? Maybe something else that is just as high a priority. So you think about this takeaway. Is it only to provide information? Well, if the answer is yes, maybe there's a better way to deliver that information. If the takeaway for our meeting is we have to focus on problems or disciplinary kinds of issues, maybe there's a better way that we can allocate that meeting time and put this at minimum. Maybe part of our time is, or part of that takeaway, is that we want people to feel good about what they do and when they contribute. And if our chapters aren't doing this on a regular basis or on a in some kind of meaningful way, maybe that's something that we need to change up. And if we're not reconnecting to that larger purpose or mission, maybe that's something we have to bring in. So let me give you a couple of things to think about. Instead of that officer report, committee report, old business, new business, let's change up what we do. And even if we don't change it every single time, maybe occasionally, Just throw in something new, something different that people haven't seen before, just to keep them on their toes. So, information, any of the crap that we would put into reports, just email it. Put it on a Google Doc. Put it someplace that is publicly accessible for all of those members. And just say, hey, if you want to see what people are doing, check your email. And you'll probably have to say that multiple times because we know folks don't read email. But that's all right. Even if they don't read it, if it is available to them, kind of like syllabi in classes. I put syllabi out for every one of my classes. I know students don't read it, but when they come and ask me a question, I say, hey, it's in the syllabus. Did you read it? It's there. And do the same thing here. We make that information available to all the members so they can access it whenever they need it. And then we don't have to talk about it as much in a public setting. That would be great. Any of the routine processes that we have, like disciplinary issues, if we have a committee, whether it's our executive committee with our officers or an actual committee that handles a particular area, let them do their job. We don't have to go back and do their job again for them. If we put them on that committee, then trust them to get that job done. And that frees up time when the rest of the chapter meets. And that's time that we can use to do some other things. So when we get together, if we have pulled out that routine information sharing and those routine processes that tend to take up 70 to 80% of the time that we have in chapter meetings, well, what can we do? Well, we can recognize folks in a meaningful way. We don't have to have a parade or anything, but we can recognize folks in a very meaningful way. Now we can use that time to brainstorm, to think about some different things, to try and maybe get us out of a rut of doing the same thing year after year after year after year. Brainstorm some new directions. Maybe we've got some more difficult issues that we have to tackle, that we need that time. And now we can put it and not have to worry about our meetings running 4, 5, 6 hours long. Which I don't know about you, I've sat through some meetings that ran 4, 5, 6 hours long. And I was like, what in the hell? Right? And that just sucks. We start at 7, and all of a sudden it's 1 a.m. You gotta be kidding me, we're still meeting. We can also use our new time to have fun. Right? We can even get out of whatever room we meet in, whether it's at the band hall or some other place, the student union. Maybe we just have a meeting someplace else. Let's meet at a restaurant. We're just not going to do any business. Let's just meet at a restaurant. We're going to have dinner. Let's meet at a movie theater. We'll go watch Star Wars, and then, you know, when we're done, we'll just hang out for a little bit, and we'll just kind of chat. But you can have those meetings in different locations than in the same room every single time, where people sit in the same chair every single time, next to the members of their clique every single time. You mix it up so that people recognize, hey, going to a meeting is actually going to be kind of cool, because it won't be the same crap every single day. And if you get rid of that routine stuff, now you have additional time that you can play with and mix a bunch of these other things together. So you think about all of this. We'll wrap this up, and then we've got a few minutes, about 10, 15 minutes for questions and comments. Think about all of this stuff. If you want to keep people motivated, fundamentally, what you need to think about is their time. Time is precious. And I will tell you, if your personality is anything like mine, I hate having my time wasted. I hate it. And I have gotten up and left meetings because I felt like my time was being wasted. And there are groups that I belong to that I don't participate in much because I feel like my time is always wasted when I show up. And there's other groups for which I am one of the formal leaders. I have one of those positions because it's a higher priority for me. But it's all based on time. And so if we're going to keep people motivated as leaders, that's what we have to fundamentally respect. Their time. And we can't waste it. So as we're doing this, we have to make sure, because these are actions we have to take as the leaders of our group, we have to make sure that our chapter remains a priority for everyone. And that means we got to focus on those people who want to contribute, but may not otherwise do so proactively, that middle group. We have to focus on them and develop them so that maybe they move a little bit farther up that middle group. Maybe some of them spill into that top group. Maybe some people in the bottom group actually move into the middle because we've started doing stuff like this. But we focus on the people that are most likely to benefit from those efforts rather than the people that no matter what we do, it's not going to matter. They're still not going to contribute. So we focus on that middle group. We change up the structure of what we do as a group. Don't fall into that routine. Don't think you have to do things the way they've always been done because of some sense of tradition or history. Tradition is literally a code word for we're not going to do anything different because that means we have to think about something new. Tradition means we can put our brain on autopilot and just go through the motions. And as soon as you go through the motions, guess what? People aren't going to allocate their time because it seems like a waste. Those are two great places to start. Focus on that middle group, change up how we do those meetings, and make sure everything is connected into a greater sense of purpose that respects people's time. So, that's it. Questions, comments, protests. Yeah.
So let's say you have some people who are very dedicated on doing the way it's always done. And they're they want to put forth time, they put forth the time, they do their work, they do whatever, but they feel like an alternate way would be a waste of their time.
Great question. So there's always going to be folks that love that sense of tradition, that sense of history, continuity, whatever word you like. And don't get me wrong, sometimes those traditions are actually really good. But how can you separate when the tradition is really good versus when it's just a crutch for not wanting to do something else? And I always encourage people to ask, well, why are we doing it this way? And if the answer is, well, we do it this way because, and there's actually a legitimate answer to that that follows the because clause, then it seems to me that's a worthwhile tradition to keep, right? Because if it's working, then don't get rid of it. But if the answer is, well, we do this because, I don't know. We do this because that's the way we've always done it. That's not a legitimate answer. That means we're doing it so that we can put our brains on autopilot. So if we have a good answer for why we do what we do, then I think absolutely you should keep it. But if we don't have a good answer for that, then that seems like a really good candidate for switching things up. Great question. Yeah.
So I had kind of a thought sort of on that. If there are some people who are really set in their ways about things, not necessarily in an obnoxious way, but just, it's their comfort zone, maybe would it be helpful to just start out by changing one aspect and then building up from that?
Sure, and think about what we talked about this morning.
Yeah.
Whenever we're going to do something new or different, it's best to start small. So same thing here. If you're going to change up the structure of how you're going to hold meetings, start small. And then just kind of build from there. Starting small also gives you the benefit of you can do something, have it be successful, and then use the momentum to then do something else. Get some success there, and you start chaining those things together and building up some momentum. And if you chain 3, 4, 5, 6 small changes together, all of a sudden, that's a pretty substantial difference. but we've done it piecemeal. Now, granted, that takes additional time, and recognize time is precious. So, but that seems like it might be a worthwhile investment if it's going to keep more people motivated and engaged.
I have a question. So, I was talking about the motivation for like the top group and other group as well. I've seen people, whether in my chapter or in other chapters as well, were at the top group, then something happened, whether that be their burnout, as you said, or typically, obviously, like maybe they lost an election, or any other situation.
Sure.
They go, and then all of a sudden, boom, they find themselves. I thought I would see them at the bottom group. What would you say, like, to help, like, make sure that to minimize as much, or maybe not even minimize at all, make sure they don't fall down that to always or down the bottom group?
Great question. So, when you have a situation where someone has been very, very involved, and then something happens, and all of a sudden they're not involved, so they go from the top to the bottom. A couple things to think about, one of which is, why did that change happen in the first place? Because if the answer is, well, that person, it was all about them, and they either needed to be in the spotlight or they weren't going to do anything, sort of a my way or the highway, then chasing after that person might be a wasted effort. Whereas if that person was really committed and then losing an election or whatever, they're no longer as committed, but they still want to be part of that group, then reaching out to them and saying, okay, well, let's see what we can do to kind of put you back into the middle, maybe even towards the top of the middle, even if you're not in that top group, that might be worthwhile to pursue. So you got to ask, you know, what was the person's initial motivation for being in that top group? And if it was a selfish kind of motivation, maybe pursuing them isn't worth your time. That said, regardless of whether that was a selfish motivation or not, if you think having the person more engaged is worthwhile, that's when you reach out and say, hey, can you work on something a little bit smaller? You've got expertise in this area. We need this. Can you work on this? And you start bringing them in just sort of a piece at a time, a small project at a time. Maybe they'll realize what got them connected in the first place, and they'll kind of come back. And maybe they don't come back all the way, and that's perfectly fine. But at least you've got them back into the middle, and they're no longer part of that problem bottom group. Very good question, yeah.
So in terms of motivating middle group, you touched slightly on how sometimes they're not exactly comfortable coming forth with many of the great ideas that they have about like projects or whatever have you. So how would you go about creating an environment where that those middle group people feel comfortable bringing their ideas forward?
Well, part of it can just be kind of a brainstorming session. So you can take part of our chapter meeting and say, all right, you know, maybe we break up into small groups and take individuals that you think or know have really good ideas, put them together in groups of three or four or maybe five, and let them brainstorm among themselves, and then have each of those smaller groups report out what they brainstorm. Then they feel like they're in that opportunity where it's not sort of them against the entire chapter offering ideas, but it's them just kind of collaborating with three or four other people. And maybe that makes it much, I don't know, I was about to say safer, and that's probably the wrong word, but at least it's an environment that is more conducive towards getting those ideas out in the open. And that's probably a great way to begin. Second way is just pull them aside in a private conversation and say, hey, we've got this coming on. I'm asking a whole bunch of people what they think would be a good way to pursue this or for their own ideas. What do you think? And you just have a one-on-one conversation and you just keep encouraging the other person to offer additional ideas. And then you just sit and listen. If that person thinks that, hey, you know, you are really interested in what they have to say, they're much more likely to offer ideas in a one-on-one or in that small group rather than in the large chapter setting. So I do a combination of those two things and see where it leads. So, very good question. Yeah?
So,
So that's a great, great question as well. I think if you have committees or any kind of structure that is tasked with something and that something isn't getting done, that's a good time in a chapter meeting to talk about how you move forward. But recognize, when you're in that chapter setting, that larger group setting, if you're going to use your time to basically point fingers and place blame, you have now wasted everybody's time. Whereas if you use that collective time to say, okay, forget about who was responsible for X, let's discuss what we need to do in order to move forward, now that's a good use of the whole group's time. Because we're not placing blame, we're not trying to criticize, we're just literally saying, okay, this has to get done. Regardless of how we got here, what do we need to do in order to move forward? And that seems to me a good use of chapter time. That would, I would throw that into one of those larger issues that needs a bit more brain power in order to solve.
And then following that, so what if it's a constant thing with that personal committee that any group of them can do with the group after, or the chapter after? Do you just continually do it that way? Or do you...
So that's also a good question. So let me, if this is a repeated thing, either from an individual or a small group of individuals, that deserves a separate, somewhat private conversation about why things are breaking down. And we will talk actually a bit more about that when we move into the next session, because there's part of the ritual that kind of speaks to that. And so let me save the more detailed comments for when we get to that part. Okay?
So when you talk about like publicly recognizing contributions of individuals, do you have any like more specific suggestions for like how often or how many should be, like, because we do a Brother of the Month where we like nominate people and we say like, this is why we think you should get the Brother of the Month, and that's always like good, but you know, there are 8 months and we have 35 entries. So sometimes like there are people who could and should get recognized.
I understand. So here's the thing about recognition. It can be done in a whole variety of different ways. And those ways can be very formal, like a Brother of the Month kind of thing. Can also just be a very informal. Like, you know, if somebody did something the other day and you're just like, hey, you know what, I want to give a quick shout out to Emily for not being a jerk because she didn't throw the two. Right? Just something very quick like that can be very, very meaningful to an individual and doesn't have to be formal, doesn't have to take more than a minute's worth of time. Another thing that I think is very useful, a lot of organizations, maybe less so our chapters, but other organizations you may become a part of either now or in the future, they don't take time to get to know each other as members. And even in our chapters, let's face it, we are much closer with some brothers than we are with others. And it's just natural, right? We just become friends with some brothers more so than we do others, which is perfectly fine. But sometimes that can translate into just not knowing other people in our group. Like, I serve on a couple of boards in Columbia, South Carolina, and I couldn't tell you really anything about any of the other board members. And they couldn't tell you anything about me because we just haven't taken the time to learn about each other. And it seems to me at the beginning of any of our meetings, take 10, maybe 15 minutes and let folks tell you about their day or tell you about their week. If somebody's having an issue, let them come forward and just say, hey, just want to let you know, in the next week I've got 4 exams coming up. Not sure I'm going to pass any of them. So, you know, if you see me and I become a jerk, just recognize I'm a bit stressed. But we don't take time to do that. So that's less of a recognition for somebody about what they did specifically, but more in terms of recognition about them as individuals. And if we can take time to do that, that goes a long way as well. So we got time for one other question, and then we kind of need to break.
Meetings like shorter and maybe not shorter but like more involved is to have
trust in those committees. Because I feel like in my chapter, everything has to be important for the entire chapter. And like we won't even let attendance go by without the entire chapter approving it. So how do I, start building that trust to let, you know, these couple brothers will take care of it and they'll do a good job?
I think fundamentally you have to have a conversation of why you have committees in the first place. And if the answer is, well, the chapter as a whole has to rubber stamp everything that a committee does, and the chapter is doing more than just the rubber stamp of what the committee does, then your committee structure is not working for you. You have asked a group of people to focus solely on this, but then the chapter is going to come in behind their backs and basically focus on that as well in a chapter setting. It means your committees are just incredibly inefficient. And so I would have a conversation in the chapter. Why do we have committees? What do we want them to do? And if the answer is, we're not sure, or everything has to come back through the chapter anyway, then ask the follow-up. Why? If we're trusting people to do this, why can't we trust them to actually do it? Now, if something comes up, and like we had said earlier, something slips through the cracks, then absolutely we need to have a mechanism for accountability that probably comes before the full chapter. But if things are working well, then so what? Let them work. Otherwise, I'll use the analogy, and this is going to piss her off, but that's okay. Okay, so if you ever see my wife, and for the broadcast, my wife gets fundamentally ticked off when nobody does the dishes, whether it's me or my two kids. And they're both teenagers, so they are perfectly capable of doing the dishes. But every time I do the dishes, she will then come back in and rearrange everything in the dishwasher that I put in. And that pisses me off to no end. To which I have come back to her and I've said, look, you get mad because nobody else does the dishes. But when I do, you completely rearrange, which sends the signal to me that you don't care about me helping out. You just want to complain. And I say, you cannot have it both ways. If you want me to do stuff, recognize I will do it different than you do. It doesn't mean it's better or worse, it's just different. And if it's not the way you want it done, then your only other choice is to do it yourself. But that means you can't complain that no one else is stepping up. So you decide and you let me know. Because I'll be honest, I'm happy not doing the dishes. I'm also happy not getting yelled at for not contributing around the house. So you tell me which one you would prefer. And we've had to have that conversation multiple times. Because, you know, she'll say, no, I really want your help. And then I'll do stuff, and that'll work well for a couple of months, 6 months maybe. And then we kind of get back into things. And I'm like, you remember that conversation we had 6 months ago? We're right back here. And it sounds like your chapter's kind of in that similar situation. And you just need to have an honest-to-God kind of conversation about what you want. And so if you want the chapter to decide everything, then don't have committees and don't waste people's time with committee work. But if you want committees so that the whole chapter doesn't have to make a group decision on everything, then let the committees do their job. And I will say, that is one of, and we'll close here, that is a great sort of quality of an effective leader. Put a good team together and you let your group do their job and get out of the way. And if you have done well in terms of who you put on specific committees, then you don't need to follow up behind them to make sure it gets done. Trust them that they will get it done. It may not get done the way you would do it if it were up to you, but that's okay. As long as the work is getting done, then how it gets done becomes less of a concern. Less. Not, you don't have to completely ignore it, but it becomes less of a concern. So, very good question. That said, we're about out of time. Actually, we're a few minutes late. So, we're going to take a 10-minute break, and then we're going to come back, and we're going to spend time talking about leadership and how it's connected to third degree. So, we're going to have a lot of information thrown at us. over like a 2.5 hour period of time. So go get some water, get some caffeine, get whatever you need in order to get us through that next session, and I'll see you back in 10 minutes.